So, you know, we know that despite the fact that the crisis was very strong in many countries, economic activity levels have recovered the pre-crisis levels, right? Like in most countries, GDP now is higher than it was in 2008 again. So there has been an economic recovery. What is worrying is that when you look at the labor market, and very specifically at inequality indicators, you clearly see how this recovery in the economy has not translated into a recovery in disparities within countries. And that's what we have been talking about here. And this is very clear by looking at many different indicators. For example, if you look at household disposable income levels, you know, like the money that families have after taxes, you know, and in real terms, after taking into account inflation, you see how in most European countries is still household disposable income levels are below what they were in 2008 before the crisis. So they have not recovered fully. It is very dramatic in Mediterranean countries, but in those countries that we believe that they weathered the crisis much better, like France or Germany, still that's the case in many segments of their societies, that household disposable income levels have not recovered to the levels they had before the crisis. Which as well, that very important is, for example, in other indicators, such as the size of the middle classes. For example, you know, the middle classes are very important, not only because of their economic function, but as well because, you know, they are very useful to finance the welfare state, as well they provide political stability in countries. And again here, when you look at the data of European countries, what you see is like in two-thirds of European countries, even now today, the size of the middle class is smaller than what it was in 2008. So, you know, we haven't seen a full recovery of what was the case before the crisis. And as I told you, the same thing about inequalities. You know, household disposable inequalities in around two-thirds of European countries, they are still now larger than they were before. Of course, one is to expect, you know, that that's the title of this panel, like inclusive growth and inequality. One is to expect that if economic growth, you know, continues in the next years, we should expect inequalities to, you know, be reduced. But we don't have to take that for granted because, as I tell you, you know, the recovery of inequality indicators is very, very slow in the last years, much slower than economic activity. And then, for example, my two colleagues, Philippe and Raymond, they have already mentioned several policies that, you know, can be, of course, helpful in reducing these inequality levels. I will not go into detail with most of them, but I can provide you, for example, something we have been doing research on is the impact of there's a very interesting example, precisely about minimum wages that Raymond was mentioning, and in the case of Germany, for example. Germany, up to 2015, the way they negotiated minimum wages was through collective bargaining. Social partners negotiated the minimum wages, and at some point they were quite dissatisfied with the results of the system because a lot of workers were not being protected with minimum wage force. And then the government decided to step in, and they introduced for the first time in history a statutory minimum wage in Germany. And in fact, it was very successful because when you look at the data, you see how this policy really increased the wage levels of those employees at the bottom of the distribution, you know, the lower paid employees. They improved a lot their incomes. And as a result, for example, in 2015, when this policy was introduced,